good afternoon. We're going to get started. My name is Deborah Gonzalez, and I'm the Director of Government Affairs for the Public Policy Institute of California, and I want to thank you for coming here today. For those of you who are not familiar with PPIC, we're a nonprofit, nonpartisan think tank that has offices in both San Francisco and Sacramento. Today's event is part of the James Irvine Foundation briefing series, and we'd like to thank them today for this event and for the lunch. For today's program, we're going to hear first from Magnus Lofstrom, who will present some of the key findings from our new PPIC report, California's Historic Corrections Reform, a copy of which should have been on your chair. Magnus's co-authors are also here today, Mia Bird and Brandon Martin, and the report as well as the slides from today's presentations are online at ppic.org. After Magnus's presentation, we will invite our panelists to the stage to broaden the conversation. In the interest of time, we won't do formal introductions. All of the participants' bios are on the back of your agenda, which should have also been on your chair. We'll save question and answering to after the panel discussion. A few more things before we begin. Later today, you'll receive a survey and via email. Please fill that out. We actually do pay attention to that. That's why we still have beer bread every meeting. And please turn off or silence your cell phones. On October 1st, 2011, California began to implement the most significant changes in correction policy in a generation. This is something Mia wrote in a report 2 years ago. These changes were brought about by inmate lawsuits and court mandates, which eventually led to the passage of AB 109. When I wrote that sentence, given my background on correction reform, and looking at this audience and how many people here participated in the drafting of the bill and the implementation process of the bill, that seemed a vast oversimplification, so I apologize. But I want to acknowledge that this was not an easy change for the legislature, local agencies, or the administration. The road to public safety realignment spanned two governor terms and multiple elections. Reducing sentences and diverting felons into local communities carries an inherent political risk. And not to suggest that legislators avoid political risk, but it is often difficult to make those choices. And staffers are particularly concerned about asking those members to make those votes. Few members wanted to vote for a bill that could potentially create the next Willie Horton. Every member wanted to do reforms that didn't increase risks to their constituents. In fact, for several years leading up to 2011, there were bipartisan efforts to handle the court mandate in a less risky way. The passage of 109 ended that dance, but change didn't stop there. Since 2011, there has been a succession of changes, including the passage of Prop 47. While this report and this panel is being presented on the fifth anniversary of realignment, the actual report reflects the larger number of changes that have gone on. And necessarily, because some of these changes are very recent and crime data lags, the report does not answer all of your pressing questions, or mine, for that matter. It is our hope that we'll be able to do follow-up reports that will get at some of those more difficult issues. What is clear is realignment is here to stay, and the governor's initiative on the fall ballot, if it passes, will add another dimension to changes and corrections. Our report and today's panel will discuss the impacts of realignment over the past 5 years. But it is our hope that today's discussion will help us identify how to enhance public safety going forward. I'd like to now invite Magnus up here to, he's a senior fellow at PPIC, Magnus Lofstrom. Thank you. I'm going to try
to do this without that. Thanks, Deborah, and thank you all for coming here today. And as Deborah said, we're going to be talking about California's recent historic corrections reforms, and the focus will be realignment and as well, to some extent, Prop 47. And importantly, let me reiterate, I have my co-authors here, Mia Bird and Brandon Martin. So before we get to those reforms, it's well worth taking a look there, and Deborah partly covered this, is how we got to the point of passing these historic reforms. And what we've seen in California was really a tremendous rise in our prison population going back to the mid-1970s when determinant sentencing was passed. And if we look at the period between 1980 and 2006, we saw a growth in the prison population that was about sevenfold. In that same period of time, spending increased as well quite dramatically, and the correction share of the state budget tripled over that period of time. We did add a number of prisons as well. We went from 11 to 33 between 1980 and 2006. But even with adding that kind of capacity, the prison population grew even faster. And by 2006, when we reached the peak of the prison population, our prisons were running about twice. They had twice as many inmates as they were designed to hold. Not surprisingly, for a system like that, being overcrowded led to poor prison conditions, alleged, and the state was sued for not providing adequate mental health and health care. And in 2009, a federal court ordered the state to reduce the prison population to 137.5% of design capacity. At that time, they meant a reduction of about 40,000 inmates. And that magic number of 137.5% of design capacity, it meant that if we bring down the prison population to around those numbers, it would give the state an opportunity to provide adequate health and mental health care. But it was really at that time in 2009 that we start to see some big reforms. And the biggest reforms, as Deborah pointed out, are really realignment and Proposition 47. And just to, I know many of you guys are very familiar with these two changes, but let me just quickly go over what they did. So in October of 2011, realignment was implemented. And what it did is it shifted correctional supervision, correctional responsibilities from the state to the counties, and it shifted funding from the state to the counties for those new tasks. There were a couple, two measures in particular that were aimed at drawing down the prison population quickly. The first one was parole violators can no longer be sent back to state prison. They are now locally sanctioned, either in county jails or some alternative sanction locally. The other part is that most lower level felons, these are our triple nons, the non-serious, non-violent, non-sexual, offenders convicted of such crime with no history of those crimes, they no longer serve their time in state prison. They're now sent to county jail. There's also a feature of this reform that was looking at addressing recidivism, the state's high recidivism rates. And the way to try to address that was to shift supervision responsibility of offenders released from state prison, from state parole to county probation. So these are post-release community supervision inmates. Prop 47, passed in November of 2014, also had some big, led to some big changes. And what it did is it reclassified a number of drug and property crimes from felonies to misdemeanors, giving offenders already convicted of these crimes an opportunity to apply for resentencing and possibly early release if they were currently serving term for those. So what have we seen? If we start to look at the prison population, we've seen a dramatic drop in the prison population since 2009. It's dropped by about 41,600. And as this graph shows, this is the total prison population, you see that the biggest impact is really realignment, about 27,000 decline in that first year of realignment alone. And then Prop 47 has also significantly reduced the prison population. In fact, about almost 80% of the drop of those 41,600 took place since realignment. So big changes in the prison population. Jail populations, not surprisingly, started to rise after realignment with this shift in responsibility from the state to the counties, and the sheriffs now having a responsibility to incarcerate some of these new felons. We see that the jail population grew in just that first year of realignment by about 9,000. It kept creeping up a little bit until Prop 47 passed. And then we see a dramatic drop in the jail population. And prior to Prop 47 was passed, on a statewide level, the population was actually greater than what the system was designed to hold. But with Prop 47 and the dramatic drop, it's dropped by about almost 10,000 in the first year of Prop 47. It's brought us below the rated capacity as well. So we have big changes in terms of incarceration here. I'm going to come back to that in a little bit. But let's take a look at crime rates. And before we get started on the possible impacts, I think it's well worth to take a look at where we are historically in terms of our crime rates. And what I'm showing you here are both the violent and the property crime rate. And the top line here is the property crime rate, and the bottom one is the violent crime rate. So these are the number of property crimes per 100,000 residents, and then similar with violent crime. And what you see here is a growth from 1960 in the property crime rates that goes till about 1980. It continues strong growth, and then since 1980, there's been a relatively steady decline. And we're now, in spite of upticks in 2012 and 2015, and as you can see here, we are at a level that we haven't seen since the early 1960s. So even when we hear about these increases, it's important to keep in mind that we're at low crime rates. If we look at violent crime rates, we see that the trend of growth continued through the 1980s until the early 1990s. And since then, we've seen a steady decline in the violent crime rate. Again, upticks in 2012 and 2015, but even with those increases in mind, we're at low violent crime rate levels. They're roughly what they were in the late 1960s. Nonetheless, I think that it's fair to say that what's on our mind and our big concern when we talk about these changes that lead to a significant decline in our reliance on incarceration is that it might have a negative impact on public safety. And where can we draw some important, crucial information about the impact? Well, still, the best case for learning about what that relationship between lower incarceration and crime is still realignment. And we have produced a number of reports looking at this relationship. And in these reports, there are a few things that we've established. And we've updated this work that I'm going to present to you very shortly. But the reform added about 18,000 offenders on the street in that first year alone. And there are no additional offenders that were added as a result of realignment beyond that first year. And there's obviously then a concern that that might have led to an increase in crime. So how do we go about answering the question if it did that? Well, in the various reports that we produced over the years, we've tackled this in a number of different ways. One way that we can try to answer this is by estimating what would the crime trends have been if we hadn't passed realignment? Well, how do we go about that? Well, we can go to the data and see if we can find states that had very similar crime rate trends to California prior to realignment. If we're successful in finding those states that had really, once we look at it, very similar or identical crime rate trends to California, then they serve as a gauge of what our crime rates would have been if we had not passed realignment. There's no other state that has passed reforms of the magnitude that we have passed here in California over this period of time. If our crime rate trends continue to match those of the comparison states, it suggests then that realignment hadn't had an impact on crime rates. If our crime rates deviate from those comparison states, it suggests that it actually did have an impact on that. Well, at least until Monday, the most recent data available for all state was carrying us through 2014. FBI released state-level data through 2015 on Monday. We didn't have quite enough time to incorporate that in this analysis here, in this report here. So we're stopping at 2014 here, which means that we're not saying anything about Prop 47 in that analysis. But let me point out what we have seen in the 2015 data. The Attorney General's office made these available in the summer, and we see that the violent crime rate went up by 8.4%. And that the property crime rate went up by 6.6% in 2015. You've seen the long-term trends. I showed you those right just a minute ago. And even with those increases, we are at historic lows. Another point that we make in the report, we have some preliminary data for other states that we look at, and it suggests that the increase that we're seeing in property crime rate, even if it's less than the increase in the violent crime rate, stands out a little bit more. Because violent crime has increased in a number of other states and the country as a whole in 2015 as well. Property crime went down. Still, that role of what Prop 47 is on crime is something that we don't know at this particular point in time. So let's take a look at what we learned from realignment. And before this report, we only covered all the up till 2013, and now we're including data for 2014 as well, a year when crime rates actually went down. And here, this illustrates the method that we're using as well. The orange line here represents California's violent crime rate trend going back to 2000. And then the teal one are the comparison states that the data is identifying to us as those states that gives us the best comparison of California's crime rate trends prior to realignment. And you see that we match up very well to those comparison states prior to realignment, suggesting that the method is sound and reasonable, and we continue to match up to those of the comparison states after realignment. If we break this down by the crimes that make up violent crime, so that is homicide, rape, aggravated assault, and robbery, and we do the analysis separately for each of those, same results. There's no evidence that realignment led to an increase in violent crime. Moving on to property crime, again, California is the orange line. And what you see is that our identification of states that look similar to California prior to realignment works quite amazingly well. You can barely separate the two lines there. So prior to realignment, we're able to find states for which California's crime rate trends was identical to, essentially. 2011, we see a slight divergence of those, and in 2012, it's noticeable. And that gap that started up in 2012, the noticeable gap, remains through 2014. So it's still there. It's roughly the same as it's been over the last few years when I've been up here telling you about what we're finding. Same thing again. We've looked at this by the separate property crimes. So we looked at larceny theft, auto theft, and burglary. And this is entirely driven by an increase in auto theft. The estimated impact by 2014 is somewhat smaller than it has been before. Before we put the number about a 17% higher auto theft rate due to realignment, that's about 15% now. Recidivism. One aim of realignment was certainly to reduce reoffending rates. We're updating some of the works that we've done before, but we're still limited to offenders who were released in the first year of realignment. But now we can follow them for 2 years. So even though they're released in late 2011 through late 2012, since we can follow them for 2 years and observe whether they've been rearrested, reconvicted, or returned to state prison, it brings us into late 2014 as well. And we're also doing something a little bit differently here in that we are dividing it up and looking at recidivism rates by those offenders who were released and supervised by the county probation, the PRCSs, and compare those to those who were released and supervised by state parole. So you have three bars here. The orange one is for all combined. The dark blue is for PRCSs, and the light blue or teal possibly is the parole population. And what we see if we start with a two-year rearrest rate, which is about 69%. After realignment. That's roughly what it was prior to realignment as well. So we don't really see much of a change there. Reconviction rate is about 42%. That's the two-year reconviction rate. That's about 5 percentage points higher prior to realignment. But given that we are observing no real changes in the rearrest rate, and there were some changes that came about with realignment, and that's essentially that parole violators now can't be sent back to state prison, they can't be incarcerated for more than 6 months on a parole violation. What we think this signifies is that a number of those offenders who would have been handled by BPH, the Board of Parole hearing prior to realignment, are now being processed formally through the courts, and that's the higher conviction rates. Our previous work suggests that as well. And then lastly, return to state prison. This is something that realignment specifically set out to change, and we certainly see that in the data. Prior to realignment, in the first 2 years since release, about 55% came back to state prison. That's now about 16%. The other part that is of interest here is the difference between those dark blue and the teal bars, the PRCSs and the paroles. And when you look at that, it looks like the PRCSs have higher recidivism rates than the parolees, which one might then conclude, falsely, as I'm going to show you shortly, that counties are not doing as good of a job as state parole. You have the two-year rearrest rate is about 5 percentage points higher than it is for state parole. But as it turns out, there are big differences in the characteristics of the offenders being supervised by counties and state parole. And here I'm showing you just one of those characteristics that the data speak to, and that's the risk of reoffending as measured by the California Static Risk Assessment Score. So this is a score that CDCR uses to try and assess what is the likelihood that someone is going to reoffend upon release. And here you see quite clearly that the counties are dealing with a higher risk population than state parole. Once you take that into account and you statistically adjust and compare the differences between parole and PRCS, you find no evidence that PRCS have higher recidivism rates than those who are supervised by state parole. In fact, the two-year rearrest rate is statistically significant, 3 percentage points shorter for PRCS as compared to state parole. Spending. Let's talk very briefly about that important issue. And one thing that you see here is what I started off saying is how our spending on correction increased going back to the 1980s. You see a steady increase in our corrections budget. This is the general funds that we're talking about here. Steep increase in the early 2000s. And then the Great Recession happened. And that's a good way to get a cut in our spending on corrections, apparently, and many other areas, unfortunately. And we see this big drop. And then the growth continues. And by this current budget year, we spend $10.6 billion on correction, and that is a historic high. And then we add another $1.3 billion in state spending in terms of realignment transfer funds. These are funds that are going to the counties to fund the new responsibilities that they're facing. Okay, so let's take a look at what do we see? Like, summarizing here and a little bit looking ahead, these reforms have significantly reduced incarceration in California. All the measures, there are a number of things that I haven't had time to talk about here, but overall we've reduced our incarcerated population since 2006 by about 55,000. We have low crime rates. You saw the figures, we have seen some increases, but they're still at low rates. But there are a good number of challenges that remain for the state. So let me just talk about some of those. Even with those changes, we have 200,000 inmates in our county jails and state prisons. And the state alone spends about $12 billion in corrections. And that doesn't include what the counties are spending as well. So that's a large amount of money that we spend on corrections. And just to put in a little bit of perspective, if we take from general funds, what we spend on corrections, we spend roughly the same as the states of Texas, New York, and Florida on corrections as those three do combined. It's a good amount of money that we spend here. Even with these drops in the incarceration and prison population, we are below the federal mandate by about 2,100 inmates. That's good news. The not so good news is that it started to tick up again. Going back to February of this year, we see an increase of about 1,600 inmates. That's a short period of time. And if that continues at this pace, by next year, it would be challenging to keep that population below the federal mandate. We have seen improvement in healthcare. The state has spent part of that increase in spending is towards improved healthcare. The state needs to continue to improve the healthcare in order to regain control from the federal receiver who's currently overseeing and in charge of the healthcare system. There are 4 state prisons now where the state has taken over control. That's 4 out of 34. There's been big changes for the counties as well, and I haven't had a chance to talk about it, but I'm sure that in the panel we'll hear more about this. But the counties will have to adapt to these changing correctional populations that they are facing with these reforms. That means that the county sheriffs, in terms of their jail populations, the county probations, but also for the courts as well, maybe particularly so with Prop 47. There are some challenges there that the counties will have to adapt to. Broadly speaking, what I think we need to do, both at the local, the county, and the state level, what we need to do is we really need to identify and implement cost-effective strategies to reduce reoffending. So if we can effectively do that, it will have an incredible widespread benefit. First of all, if we can in meaningful ways reduce reoffending, we reduce the pressures on the state prison and the county jail systems. Spending, we would see improvement if we move towards cost-effective strategies. We're spending a lot, so we need some improvements there. Public safety, reduced reoffending means improved public safety. And then also importantly, it would improve the lives of those who are in our criminal justice system and their families as well. So I think that's really what we need to focus on in moving forward here. And lastly, we do need to know what the effects of Prop 47 on crime is. We don't know at this point. The good news is that we're now at a point when those data that are needed in order to start to shed light on that question are becoming available. The release of the FBI data this week is something that will help. We're also working with the Attorney General's office, and they're providing us with other data that will help us in a meaningful way shed light on this issue as well. So with that, I end, and I invite up our moderator, Julie Small, and our panel to come up here and continue these discussions. Thank you.
Thank you, Magnus. That was a great presentation of your report and the report that all three of you wrote. And I'm very grateful to the Public Policy Institute of California for inviting me to chair this panel. A very experienced and knowledgeable individuals, Scott Kernan, current Secretary of Corrections, Wendy Still, who's the Chief Probation Officer for Alameda County, and Sheriff Geoff Dean of Ventura County. Thank you for coming. Taking the time. I thought maybe a good place to start, backing up on the whole purpose of realignment, was to reduce the prison population, and the reason why that was ordered by the U.S. Supreme Court was to improve medical and mental health care in the prison. So I thought it might be nice to just take a moment, Secretary Kernan, to talk about, now that realignment has happened and Prop 47, and you've seen these dramatic drop in population in the prisons, what is happening with the mental and medical health care for inmates? So have you seen, what kind of improvements or changes have you seen?
Well, I think Magnus might have said that we have four prisons delegated. In fact, we have seven prisons delegated under CDCR control. We have our Office of Inspector General conducting audits, and we have a legal pathway to get out of the case. The OIG audits, and if they deem the prisons adequate, then those prisons are delegated back to us. And we have several prisons that have been audited and deemed adequate, and we're working with the plaintiffs in the receiver's office to increase the amount of delegations that we have. We do not yet have a date or a specific time period where we'll be out of the case, but we are definitely working well together with the receiver's office in advancing our pathway out. I would say that the lack of density certainly is a factor in that success, but I would also mention a significant investment, capital investment in healthcare improvement projects throughout the state. And I would also suggest to you that beyond the density that we have in our prison system today, about 129,000 inmates, that we still have a ways to go. Based on the population projections, we will run out of beds at the state level and be over that 137.5 cap in the near future. So there are still some steps that the state must do despite the significant reforms, and I agree completely, that I've undertaken in the last several years.
And we'll come back to the future challenges that Magnus mentioned, the uptick in the population. We'll talk a little bit more about that later on. I wanted to also ask Wendy Still and Sheriff Dean about some of the initial challenges that the counties have faced from your different offices with the enactment of realignment, with this influx of a new population that you're responsible for. Some of the early things that I heard as a reporter from a probation chief probation officer was that these people are much more dangerous than we expected. These are much higher risk people than we were expecting. And you know, we've heard a lot. I've heard a lot over the years from different sheriffs about the difficulty of absorbing so many more people. Obviously, the population has dropped, and big relief from Prop 47 passing, bringing it back down. But there's been a great challenge with dealing with people staying longer in the jails that were built for short stays up to a year. We have people staying years now, and we have a lot more people in the jails who have serious mental health needs. So, but I turn to you, Wendy.
From probation standpoint, I had an interesting view. I had just left the prison system, working there for almost 30 years, and went out to a county probation to be the chief in San Francisco. And that was in 2010, which was SB 678, evidence-based probation supervision. And so that's really where the counties began to change the probation departments, their perspective on how they supervised and they viewed supervision. It was moving from a surveillance model to one of strength-based and evidence-based practices. And fortunately, there was some funding attached to SB 678 and the establishment of the community corrections partnerships that allowed the counties to begin to shift in this direction. The counties were so successful with the first round of basically SB 678 that I think is what gave the governor and legislature confidence to move forward with realignment. But still, that was very quick. You know, it was basically a little over a year later that happened, and the infrastructures weren't in place within the county probation departments to be able to assume this responsibility so quickly, as effectively as they would have liked to have right off the bat. They had high caseloads. They had thousands of cases that were banked. Probation officers had caseloads that were, you know, up to the hundreds. And so that was a really challenging place to start. Many probation department had absolutely no services, no service contracts. And there were a lot of stovepipe organizations within the criminal justice partners, but also the social service agencies, the public health department. So there were a lot of challenges, but fast forwarding through those challenges, what I think is amazing, and I can say from both sides, from the prison side, right, and then from the county perspective, is just how fast the counties were able to make this shift and to be able to create the partnerships to break down the barriers to create these systems of care. And also retrain their staff, probation staff, officers. Basically, it was retraining their skill sets, you know, what is evidence-based practices, how to do motivational interviewing, developing those partnerships with the community-based organizations. All of those things had to be done in order to accept this population. Now, the population in San Francisco, I can tell you, I was the only chief in California that had the ability to just focus on the adults in realignment, because San Francisco has a split supervision. Juvenile is under one chief, and adult is under a second chief. And so that really was fortunate for me. I could really focus on it, making the changes within the organization and reaching out, bringing the researchers in. But really, because San Francisco was also so small, work on those partnerships. So I learned a lot in that. And moving from San Francisco over to Alameda, all those experiences were really helpful. But I wasn't the only chief like that. All of the chiefs basically reached out as chair of the CCP and then chair of the CCP EC, right?
And basically, CCPB, I'm sorry.
The CCP, the Community Corrections Partnership Executive Council, right? And those, they were responsible for developing the realignment plans and in cooperation with the partners. And I think that was one of the strongest benefits that the counties realized up and down the state, was basically opening those lines of communication, breaking down the barriers, and beginning to create systems of care. Along then came the Affordable Health Care Act, right, and opened up another funding source and the abilities to strengthen the relationships between public health and also the criminal justice agencies, and able for the counties to leverage the dollars with the that came along with the Affordable Health Care Act to make their realignment or their service dollars go longer. So I would say that there have been a lot of positive changes. There are a lot more services that are available. The infrastructures are in place, continuing to be, and the fidelity is growing.
And Sheriff Dean?
Wow.
We have a lot of follow-up questions.
Yeah. Well, thanks for having me. It's great to carry the banner of the Western Division champion Los Angeles Dodgers from Northern California. It's all that really matters. We can go now.
That's why he's here.
Yeah, well,
it's I think it's important to separate the term realignment. When the governor passed AB 109 and it went through, that was the concept of realignment. And that's significantly different than the impacts of Prop 47 on local agencies. I'm not much for anecdotal information. And so after we had AB 109 in our county for a while, I commissioned an outside study, and I'll just talk about Ventura County. That's what I know about, to see what was really the impact. Because before AB 109, we had 1,200 parolees in Ventura County. After AB 109, I had 1,200 parolees in Ventura County. The difference was, instead of state parole watching them, local probation and law enforcement watched them, which I think has a significant impact on the recidivism rate and the resources that were available from the state versus what's available locally. And we only found about a 3% increase in crime from AB 109. And we actually hand-pulled data from every single person for a year, because the only big change in AB 109 was their sentence was reduced to 50%. So we said, all right, that 50% of time that those people would have been in jail, how many of them reoffended and were arrested for crimes, thus affecting the crime rate? And it was only 3%. It really wasn't that significant. And I believe that local control is better to deal with these people. They live in the communities with them. They're more apt to understand the program and what's available. Prop 47 is a whole different world. I've been doing this job for almost 38 years. This is the first time I don't know how to fix this. I'll respectfully disagree with the crime rate as insignificant. It doesn't matter that it was only this bad in the 60s. If you just use the low range of numbers for the state of California at 8.4%, that means 11,500 people were additional victims of violent crime, including 1,000 additional rapes. Any of you that do numbers, go look in the eyes of a victim that was a rape victim, and tell me it doesn't make a difference. Was it all Prop 47? No. I can tell you in Ventura County, because we actually track all those people. We know the data. We know it's available. We know where the uptick has come from, both whether they're Prop 47 people, AB 109 people, or what the impact is. So 8.4% is a lot. And please, no one think that that is insignificant, even if it's not as bad as it used to be in the 60s. I don't know who the heck wants to go back to us having more victims of rapes and murders and things like that. But it's out there. And how we deal with Prop 47, I'm not really sure what's going to happen. It's an open door. Parts of Prop 47, I think were really good. Parts I don't think were good. Our drug court, it got one recipient this year. One. We average 20 to 25 per year. There's no incentive for someone with a substance abuse problem to go into drug court. Because if you have a substance abuse problem, and some of you may have one, we all know someone that has, whether it's alcohol or drugs, whatever it might be, no one wants to give that up. And without a stick and carrot approach, those poor people that are in that awful cycle of substance abuse, they're not going to take the carrot by themselves to do it. They're just not going to do it. Before you had a felony, hey, if you go to drug court, you go to substance abuse training, you're successful for 6 months, it goes away. Now it's a misdemeanor. What would I rather? I'm not going to do 15 days in the county jail. I'll get reduced by 50%. I'll have no probation tail. What are you going to take? You know what you're going to take. So there's a whole segment of that population that's not getting treatment, and the cycle continues. I have people with Prop 47 people with 15 and 20 active cases. because the courts are so backlogged with these cases, and it just cycles and cycles and cycles. My length of stay for my felons in jail, which are up over 85% now because nobody keeps unsentenced misdemeanors anymore, has increased because the courts are so backlogged that both the public defender and DA are asking for continuance after continuance after continuance. And these felons end up staying pre-sentence in jail. And I have a huge release program. I have 65 people out on EM. We have probation has a 95% success rate on pre-release, on sentencing. So we've got everybody out of jail that we can. But because of the cycle and the backup in court as a result of Prop 47, it's just backlogging and it's building exponentially on top of itself.
I'm glad to hear, I mean, I'm not glad to hear that this is the case, but I'm glad that you spoke about this because I just heard the same thing in my local police department in El Cerrito. And so I just, you know, I have a sense that, I mean, you know, we look at a statistic about something versus the experience of law enforcement, and what you're describing, this lack of incentive to go to the drug courts, is exactly what he was talking about as well. And you said, I don't want to quite let this go because it is, you know, a relevant and it's a topic that's happening now. You said you don't know how to fix this. What are you trying? And it sounds also like what was working under realignment isn't working for this population.
Well, I think realignment was a different issue. All it did is it transferred responsibility to the counties, and it actually brought some, you know, fairly adequate funding along with it. Yeah. And so we're just doing it locally instead of the state level, which is fine. I don't know what the answer is here. We're looking for programs. We're a big program county. We give a lot of money to programs in CCP and outreach and gang treatment and everything. I think the answer is to try to find programs that work. And there's so many programs out there, and everybody thinks theirs really does. We were at the BSCC meeting. I'm on the board last week, and a gentleman that came up, and I think he'd been out of prison for 90 days. He didn't say what his offense was. I'm assuming it was very violent because he'd been in 30 years. And he goes, I'm 90 days, I'm doing this. And it was public comment, but we actually started a conversation with him and say, okay, what's working for you? Because I wanted to know, and everybody on the board wanted to know. And he had a program where he's going to counseling every single day. Mm-hmm. Now this poor man, he's living with his father, who's a heroin addict, is on methadone. His mom's out on the street and she's an addict. But he said, what's helping me, and I apologize, the name, it was a great program in San Jose. Fathers and families. Yes, like it was a great, we were all getting kind of emotional. It was really good, but it's like that daily interaction. And I think we've got to continue to identify and incarcerate some really nasty offenders, but we've got to find programs that actually work and continue to pour the resources in that to get those people out of that bell curve.
What are you seeing, Wendy, in Alameda? Are you seeing similar problems, or are you dealing with this?
I'd say pretty much all the counties in discussion with the other chief probation officers. Proposition 47 created a problem because it really delinked, you know, the mandatory requirement and the incentives, you know, to go into treatment. And so I think most counties are absolutely dealing with this and trying to figure out ways to incentivize, right? But the programs that are out there, the good news is because of the money that's been brought in under SB 678 and realignment has basically created the opportunity to expand the type of programs that are out there. And I think that needs to continue. And the quality of the programs, like for example, in Alameda, one of the things that we've made a huge investment is it's $9 million in what we call a community capacity fund. And that's basically an investment in the community-based organizations so that they can create the capacity within their organization to really deliver and expand services. And that seems to be working exceptionally well. It's a huge investment, but we think that there'll be a big return on it.
I also wanted to talk about, I wanted to go back to the offenders with mental illness, because I know this is, you know, a big change or a big shift that I keep hearing about. And It appears to have been one of the biggest challenges for jails and probation, and with not enough treatment beds in the community. They've got people waiting to go to a state hospital if they're facing that, you know, they're found incompetent to stand trial. There is, and you know, the jails have tried to step up. They're in the process of building a lot of units and adding staff, but There's not really enough care, or and it's not that effective yet in the jail. So I'm wondering if you could talk about how you are handling, and also this, although I've been talking about jails, Secretary Kernan, I know it's definitely part of CDCR's mission to prepare people who are leaving the prisons who are mentally ill offenders for reentry. So I wondered if you could talk about best practices, some of the things you do to help ensure that people with mental illness, when they get out, are going to be less likely to reoffend and get on their feet.
I think I would say first, and maybe after Sheriff Dean's comments, I really would like to say that the three-time champion San Francisco Giants are beyond that, and sorry for my levity. The prisons and jails have become the de facto psychiatric facilities. There's no doubt about it. While the population has declined some 40,000, as documented in your report, the mental health population within CDCR has actually increased. There is significant investment. There was some mention about the CDCR budget, but some of the drivers of our budget are certainly the amount of resources that we are applying to try to address mental illness, both with the Department of State Hospitals and CDCR, and transition. Not to skirt your question, but I would like to address what Sheriff Dean mentioned a little bit.
That would be great.
Because I, as colleagues, I think probation and sheriffs and the state level have to work better collaboratively. And I would say that with the fast-moving criminal justice system, there is no doubt that CDCR has not done as good a job as it might to rehabilitate offenders and provide program, both mental health or substance abuse, as the sheriff mentioned, or many other areas. And the governor has invested a significant amount of money to try to expand programs within CDCR to try to address it. We have to do a better job of treating our offenders while they're with us. And then I think we have to have a much better handoff offenders, both with the mentally ill and others, so that we are working collaboratively to try to get them into services. In CDCR, the recidivism rates were mentioned. It's no doubt over several years, inmate that goes to substance abuse programming in prison and gets out and has aftercare in a community recidivates at a significantly less rate. So there is some significant work to be done in how we are incarcerating our offenders, both mentally ill and not. And then I think there can be a much better collaboration with probation and the sheriffs as a collective agency. I don't think, as the criminal justice system moves so fast, that there's always been that great collaboration at the county level and with probation. And I think certainly that's one of the governor's expectations, is that we do a better job working together. And then I think to Wendy's point, incentivizing offenders to go to program. I grew up in a system that was overcrowded, and 200% inmates sleeping on triple bunks, violence, you couldn't get anything done. And so the density has been reduced, not all the way yet, but we have to do something to incentivize offenders to participate in programs. And we have a system of credits today that just simply doesn't do that. And inmates will sit on a weight pile on a yard and learn how to be better criminals than participate in cognitive behavior therapy or substance abuse or get an AA degree. And I think that the governor wants to incentivize offenders to participate in that activity. And so when I do hand it off to Sheriff Dean and Chief Still, this individual might have done less time, maybe hypothetically 8 years, but got an AA degree instead of 10 years and sat on that bench. And I think public safety will be greatly enhanced if we could do that at the state level.
I just wanted to follow up on that. When you talk about backing up just to the handoff with from people coming out of prison, how could you say you want to work more closely with counties, and what does that look like? What would it entail?
So for much of the time, basically when AMA completed his sentence, he got $200 and a ride to the bus stop. We didn't give him an ID card. We didn't introduce him to local police. We didn't hook him up with housing or employment. That we all know are things that are basic necessities that will increase offenders' opportunity to not commit the crimes that the sheriff mentioned. And so I, in all of our prisons, we are making a concerted effort to do a much better job with that. I also think the sharing of information with the sheriffs and probation is an important part of that. Probation, there was the discussion about the PRCS offenders, letting them know what we're doing in the state system so that they can work on those things that are, you know, driving that inmate's or parolee's criminal thinking just makes common sense to me. And so I think we could do a lot more in that regard.
Sorry, you're going to go.
I think pre-release planning also, you know, and I know that, that CDCR does a lot of that, but actually one of the things that we did in San Francisco was having our probation officers go into the prisons and basically develop that pre-release plan prior to them being released out. And also for those that were EOP, mentally, you know, had serious mental illness, actually picking them up and others too. It wasn't just that population. I think those are the kind of innovative things that really make a difference rather than just that cold handoff. The other thing is being able to share information better. I know that CDCR plans to shortly start releasing their treatment plans to both, they were doing it for parole, but also gonna be doing it for probation, what I understand. I think that that's a really great step forward. The mental health collaboration, one of the points that I wanna make is that, you know, whether the individuals are getting out and coming back as returning citizens from the prison, from the jail, or under community supervision, they're gonna be out in the community. So really making the investment in community mental health and services is just absolutely critical. And the individualized case management, intensive case management is really critical. And one of the things that the sheriff mentioned, which has proven so beneficial and proven out in the research, is to have peer mentors involved in these programs as case managers or part of that multidisciplinary treatment team, because these are individuals that have lived through it, you know, have the resiliency to be successful and can now be good role models for those that are basically in recovery or trying to turn their life around. So I think that's an important component.
So 20%, in excess 20% of my jail population is on some sort of psychotropic medication. And like the secretary said, that's unfortunately where we go. We've got probably 15 mental health beds. We're a county of a million people. We have maybe 15 mental health beds. We have county ones. We've got some private beds. It's a real challenge. What we've done that I think has been successful, we have county, we have our own mental health professionals, but we have county people. We teach the exact same programming and treatment in there that they're gonna get when they get released. We do a warm handoff. We'll give them up to a week's worth of medication to do that. We have a probation officer inside the facility that does pre-release planning and training. We'll drive them to their first appointment because we know if they don't make that first appointment, the chances of them being successful really, really, it drops off really significantly. We're building a 60-bed facility for those with medical and mental health challenges, and we've actually brought on a group from a local university that's done some great work around the country in designing that, including aromas, lighting, colors, everything, incentives to better deal with that mental health population. The sad part is, that the sheriff is doing that. In some of these cases, these people, there's no place for them to be because they're very violent criminal offenders. And a good percentage of them, they just need to be someplace else. And I always like to remind, you know, this is a pretty informed group, but we don't pick who we get. We don't decide, the judges decide who that is. And we tend to get them because there's no place else for these people to go. And candidly, some of them are only alive because they're in our facilities.
I have many more questions, but it is 1:01, and there are so many people in this audience who are very knowledgeable on this topic, including former Secretary Matthew Cate of CDCR, now with CSAC. So I wanna turn the questions over to you. I'm sure you have some great ones. We have two ladies in the audience with microphones, so we just ask that you get the microphone first, raise your hand and they'll bring it over, or you go to them and don't talk until you get the microphone because we are recording this for the internet. There's somebody over there.
Hi, my name is Tom Hoffman. I have 33 years in public safety here in California. we don't have enough CDCR people, so I'll add to that pile. I'm the retired state director of parole. And my comment mostly is to the sheriff, who, and I respect the professionalism of your presentation, but I suggest to people that changing six offenses that were misdemeanors or felonies to misdemeanors cannot be the reason we have a problem in the criminal justice system in California. Six out of a penal code with thousands, thousands of offenses. It seems to me what 47 has done, as graphically pointed out, and our panelists are discussing this, our criminal justice system is largely dysfunctional. The pieces of the puzzle don't go well together. What the sheriff does and what the police do and what DA does and what judges do and what probation does and what parole does often don't jive. Having spent 33 years on the public safety side of this profession, the experience inside CDCR as the state director of parole for 3 years opened my eyes up to the fact that we have to do a much better job in public safety with connecting the dots. The system, we call it a system, but system suggests that from the moment of arrest to the moment of release from the secretary's institutions, we all understand what our desired outcome is. That is not the case. 47 certainly isn't perfect, no piece of legislation is, but to suggest that that is the problem when we talk about mental illness, when we talk about availability of programs, when we talk about staffing in probation, when we talk about staffing in parole, these are the things that we need to talk about, because at the end of the day, Mr. Kernan, Secretary Kernan has about 117,000 beds, period. And the sheriff and his other 56 sheriffs who have jails, they have about 90,000 beds. And we have 38 million people in our state. This is an unavoidable reality. It's going to take real concentration and real teamwork to resolve.
Thank you for your comment. Would any of you like to respond to that?
Yeah, I would just like to say, I don't think anyone said that Prop 47 is the problem. The question was, what are the impacts of Prop 47? Prop 47 is one of the issues, and in Ventura County, we've actually tracked just Prop 47, see what those reoffenses mean. And I agree, if you take some of those crimes and you made them misdemeanors, it was just fine. I am never going to get past that possession of a date rape drug or possession of a gun by a gang member should be a misdemeanor. So I partially agree with you, and the other part is, and no one says that Prop 47 is the only problem here, but I think we're just addressing what are the impacts of Prop 47 based on what data that we have now.
Anyone else? I'll wait for the microphone, please.
We as a society, I think, have a false sense of reverence for the utility of arrest and incarceration as the key gold standard for public safety. We all recognize, I hope, that as an example, homicides in our nation, you're lucky if you solve half of them. The crimes identified in Prop 47, we're lucky if we solve and arrest 1 out of 5. Aggravated assaults, about 40%. Rapes, the ones that are reported, God knows we don't report our rapes because it's often family members and friends, around half. So if we're really convinced or really committed that public safety is what we're all about, then it seems to me we ought to be giving as much attention at least to the 80% of our victims in these crimes in 47, or half of our homicide victims, or half of our rapists who never see any justice. We've got to focus on the causative factors of crime instead of chasing our tail, catching 1 out of 5 or 1 out of 2 of the crooks after the fact.
Okay, thank you. Did anyone want to respond to that, or should I take another question?
Well, I'll jump in there for just a quick comment, is to say that I really think that that's what 678 and 109, and we'll see if 57 passes, is allowing us to do and mandating us to do, is work together to create these continuums that reduce victimization, reduce crime by virtue of treating the individual of whatever the risk and needs are. And that's why building out the capacity within the community and dealing with such huge issues such as NIMBY, because even trying to build out the capacity, if you can't place the facilities there, right, then you need to have you need to have the programs located close to where the population is. So, and then again, incentivizing, but I don't think anybody is saying that that's the goal that we haven't changed. I think we've changed our perspective from the vast majority of criminal justice partners. The conversation I have now versus the conversation that I'd had 15 years ago inside CDCR is much different. Even the conversation 5 years ago between sheriffs, DA, probation, and public defender, many of the conversations would have never happened 5 years ago. So I think that is showing a shift in the direction.
Do we have another question? Anyone?
Mark Carlson with the Lutheran Office of Public Policy, and somewhat embarrassed to say a career after this morning's headlines, a career seasonal with CAL FIRE retired. I think the day shouldn't pass without some acknowledgement of the extraordinary work going on in the Santa Cruz Mountains right now. And last night at midnight, I heard a Trinity River crew, where I finished out my career in that area, poking around in the mountains. The Mercury News has an antelope crew bus, an aerial photo up there. So I know there's been some challenges with the change in population. How's that going from a county and a state perspective?
You're talking about fire crews?
Inmate fire crews, yeah. Both county and the state level.
I mean, certainly from the state level.
Really working hard right now in a number of locations.
Yes. From a state level, as the population has shifted, they discussed it was certainly the lower level offenders that were shifted out of the system that has made it a challenge for us to keep our fire camps completely full. In our cooperation with CAL FIRE, though, we have continued to make great strides to staff our fire camps. I want to say, please don't quote me, 4,000 or so, 3,800, I think, are currently fighting fires across the state. So we have, in cooperation again with CAL FIRE, been able to do that and continue to provide that great service and committed to doing so in the future.
CDCR lowered their rates, more competitive, so the counties could afford to send their inmates that qualified to fire camps. And so that's, in fact, we just signed a contract with CDCR to do that. I mean, the fire camps are great, but I actually have one about 5 minutes from where I live. And we know it's a vital resource. So the county, working with CDCR, I think we're trying to fill that gap as best we can. Because we know, I mean, all the work that is done by those inmate crews at a significantly reduced cost to the taxpayer.
That's one of the programs that over the years I've always heard great things about. Like, this is one of the best things that CDCR does to help inmates prepare for release. So, another question?
Hi, Natasha Minsker with the ACLU. My question is for Professor Lofstrom where's the professor? So Professor, I'm just curious at your comment about the PRCS population being a higher risk than the parole population. And it looks from your chart, if I'm reading this correctly, they are higher risk specifically for property crime and drug crime, or does that mean individuals with a conviction for property crime and drug crime happen to score higher risk? Can you unpack that a little bit more?
Sure, I'll happily do that. Streamlined it in the presentation here, and if you look in the report, we break down that high risk of offending into whether you're high risk of committing a violent crime, a drug crime, or property crime. And I just showed you the combined score here. And you see, what you see in those graphs is that for both drug and property, PRCSs are much more likely to commit upon release one of those types of crimes, whereas parolees are actually more likely to commit a violent crime than PRCS. Does that help?
Yes, that's very helpful.
Right, thanks.
Any other questions? I saw somebody's hand up over here earlier. The mic is coming to you.
My name is Shirley Darling. I'm a member of the public. Mm-hmm. I was wondering, when I see these large increases in the budget, I was wondering the breakdown of that. Does that mean they're increasing salaries? Are they increasing the quality of the food in prisons? Are they increasing rehabilitation programs? How How does that work? When you, I mean, you just see this huge increase and you don't know what exactly it means.
In 2011, I believe we were about 11% of the overall general fund, and today we're about 9%. And I know it's confusing. It's confusing for me as well that we would drop 40,000 offenders, but that our budget would be about the same that it was in 2011. But there's a lot of impacting factors, and you mentioned one of them, salaries. For our 60,000 employees is certainly an impacting factor. We built a healthcare facility in Stockton, and we're doing, I mentioned briefly, the healthcare improvement projects that we have going across the state to improve healthcare, the physical plant for our medical staff, all adding lease revenue bond resources that we have to pay for. So there's these factors that occur in our budget that we really have no that are significant increases in our budget. I can assure you I'm not spending any more on food than I did probably 3 years ago. Very prudent governor, fiscally prudent governor, and is very concerned. I will also say that he has made a significant investment in rehabilitative programs. As I said, we're going to have substance abuse programs in all of our prisons, 35. We're going to have cognitive behavior therapy, long-term offender program, reentry services. So the governor has made a significant investment. Back in when the economic downturn, as was noted in the charts, we lost all of our, or a lot of our rehabilitative programs. And so the governor has invested in bringing that infrastructure back up, and we are servicing more today than certainly we were several years ago.
I would not mind if you made better food for them.
No, I wasn't suggesting otherwise. I would love to make the food more nutritious, but I understand your point.
Okay. I think I saw another hand up over here. She's coming with Mike.
Hi, this question is for Secretary Kernan. I wondered, you might have just alluded to it in your previous answer, but I wondered if you guys are collecting individual offender level data on programming that they received, and have you correlated that yet to the success, as this report suggests, then investing in the most cost-effective programs, and if so, what are those programs?
So I think the short answer is yes. I might refer to my staff here, but I will say that we are trying to do a better job of identifying those programs that are working. We've engaged with Pew MacArthur to do a results first initiative where we're doing a cost benefit analysis and work very hard to get the data and be able to, by the end of the year, hopefully be able to identify for every dollar that we spend on substance abuse, what is our return on investment? So that as we then expand that from substance abuse to other programs within CDCR, we will have a better idea of those evidence-based programs that are providing the greatest benefit. I would also say to you, as somebody that's worked in the prison system for a long time and a warden at a couple different places, that having inmates engaged in positive programming, innovative grant programming, or arts and corrections, while it might seem not the greatest investment, is actually a very good investment in getting inmates actively engaged in positive programming and away from the criminal element. And that is not to suggest to you that there is not a level of criminal element in our prisons. Every day we have riots and violence in our prisons. But I would tell you from when I left in 2011-ish and came back that there's a hope amongst the MA population now. I think there's a greater hope amongst staff that we're doing a better job of engaging all disciplines. I mean, my vision of the department would be that, and this happens more than anybody thinks, is that my correctional staff are engaged in focusing on rehabilitation program. I do believe that that's happening a lot. It can happen some more. So yes, we want to be a data-driven organization that's looking at these results. That's why the partnership with PPIC and this data report is so important to us, so that we are looking at our populations and we're looking at our programs to spend the limited dollars that I have on the best programs.
In Ventura County, we actually, CCP funding requires a report card before the funding will continue about the success rate, and not just how many people you took into your program, but how many were successful, both using the state definition of recidivism and some other definitions for substance abuse, because we know, you know, substance abuse treatment usually has multiple failures before somebody may be successful.
The counties have made significant investments in terms of their AB 109 money and also some of their 678 money, which 678 required a 5% mandated investment and evaluation and research, but in strong relationships with researchers to know what basically the return on investment recidivism outcomes are, and also doing creative things like developing portals to the providers. So not only could the officers make referrals easy, we could get data back easy on the progress of those referrals, and we're just in the process of going live with ours in Alameda in October.
Just following up on that, is there a specific program that you've already identified that's cost effective and effective?
If I had to pick one off the top of my head, I would say Thinking for a Change Cognitive Behavioral Programming, which does change criminal thinking.
Does anybody else have a program that you think is working well?
Yeah, the I would say recognition. Come on, somebody say it for me.
More recognition.
Thank you.
Therapy.
Yes.
That's what is it?
Dodger fan.
I told MRT. Stick me to one syllable words. Has had some really good success when it's coupled with ongoing counseling.
I'm sorry, which was it? Cognitive recognition? I didn't actually hear.
More recognition.
More recognition therapy.
Thank you.
More recognition is the program?
Recognition. Therapy. Yeah, recognition, thank you.
Recognition.
The other thing, one more, is that charter schools, one byproduct of the realignment is strong relationships with charter schools. Five Keys Charter School was started in San Francisco, went down to LA, is now in Alameda and other counties. And you know, you're blending the availability of funding from the ADA population, right, the pupil population, with then the treatment funding, and then also now extending it out into career technical type training. And they're seeing great success out of that.
What about you, Secretary Kernan? You mentioned, you alluded before to, addiction treatment and those sort of programs.
You know, this governor's invested $430 million into a variety of programs, and so it's difficult for me to address it. I've mentioned many of them, but college-level programs are going on in 29 of our prisons today. We are doing more with tablets and through the television. We have space limitations in our prisons, and so we have to look for creative ways. One of the challenges, I think, for my job, should Prop 57 pass, and we do get that incentivizing of offenders for programs, I have to do more programming in our prisons than is currently being done today. All the more to your question about making sure that we're investing good money as we expand those programs. But we are trying a variety of programs, studying them, and then we will, of course, report on that very transparently. And it's my hope that we can focus our resources on the programs that are going to provide the best reduction in recidivism.
And we have another question at the back.
Hi, Pam Douglas, CCPOA. My question is about the public. They're not here. The average citizen is not up on the curve of what's going on. You still have problems citing places. Is there anything formally being done by your agencies to engage the public so they're part of our process of welcoming parolees home?
It's a great question. I mentioned reentry and the transitions in prison, but we have implemented seven male community reentry, and we have some female reentry programs, and I think it was $32 million that the governor invested in trying to expand reentry with the concept of putting an offender, instead of $200 into the gate, transition him sometime before he's going to leave prison, and have him in the community with which he's going to be so that services can be plugged into him. And one of the biggest barriers has been the NIMBY issues that Ms. Still brought up, and our inability to cite cite those facilities. And so we have, as I said, we have seven, and we really don't have a lot of prospects. The governor did put $25 million into the budget to incentivize communities, counties, to help site these facilities in the future. But certainly more work needs to be done to try to get community support and public support, as you put it.
Any other questions?
Really?
Matthew, Kate.
So Governor Brown has been extraordinary in listening to counties, the sheriffs, probation chiefs, supervisors, and then making changes that we've suggested, funding jails, providing additional funding when the 678 process needed to change, all those things, one after another. I think our concern is now Prop 57 is on the horizon, and the counties are a little bit split. The probation chiefs are in support, the DAs are in opposition, there's a number that are kind of in the middle. The question really is for Dr. Lofstrom and Dr. Byrd. How do you measure when you have a realignment, Prop 47, Prop 57 in stair steps? How are you going to be able to help us discern how it's going and what kind of things need to be changed when you have that amount of change in that period of time?
You know, it's a difficult thing to do because you not only have the cumulative context of those reforms carrying over into each other, but you also have contextual change. You know, we have national changes, we have state level changes, and what we want to do is to do our best to account for all of those changes and then also to account for differences in the offender population over time. And so that's what we're up to. Given good quality data, we can apply the best methodologies we have to try to do that. We'll probably never stand up here and say, this is absolutely the exact effect of this policy, but we will try to take all the evidence, you know, we can pull together. And I think Prop 47 is definitely our next target. We're going to be looking at crime and recidivism effects. And then we'll see from there if there are more changes. But it's just so amazing to be part of this conversation with you all. And I think we learn so much every time we talk to practitioners that we can then bring to the data that we're looking at and understand better how to interpret it. So thank you so much to everyone who continues to give us feedback.
There's really not much to add to that great answer. I think that it's... there is also that accumulation of effects that is difficult to disentangle. That's part of it is there's complexity of how they're playing out, and that's where we're having conversations with the various actors that are affected and have a better understanding of what's going on so that when we are trying to use the data to answer these questions, we have a better understanding of what those potential effects are. Prop 47 will be a more difficult question to answer what impacts it will have than realignment, partly because of what you're describing. There are some good news when we looked at prop with realignment effect and crime and the mechanisms that we're thinking about that it could affect crime, they played out very quickly, and within a year it played out. So when we see things that coincides with the changes, the new changes, that's one of the dimensions that we're looking at. So they're challenging questions to address, and they require some thoughtful and thorough work to do it in a reliable way. So.
Any other questions? Any follow-up questions? Anyone? We have 5 minutes, are you sure? One more here?
It doesn't require a microphone.
They want to record it for the internet. Thank you.
Is there a chart available anywhere that shows the diminishing PRCS population and the maybe 10 years out what that is estimated to be? Curious.
I know we certainly keep it at a county level. You know, probation keeps it about the number of people they're tracking and how that number has actually been going down.
Yes. Has it decreased over the years?
Yes.
I'm just looking at a survey that was just produced in on PRCS's 2013. There was 33,151. 2014, there was 33,500. 2015, there was 31,500, just a little over that. And so the PRCS population has decreased.
Is there ever a point where it just kind of goes down to nothingness, or?
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, but fewer of these people are going to state prison in the first place now. And so they don't become PRCSs. It's kind of what we call them. I think probation is still seeing a certain part of that population, but they're not people that they're people the state used to have and don't take all of them any longer. So I think that's part of that diminishing number. And you have fewer of them that are getting sentenced under the felony rules and the parole or the probation standard. So I believe that's part of the number going down. It's not that there's necessarily...
Right. That's what I meant, the ones that are...
But I don't think that they'll ever go away because of the criteria. You know, it's their prior conviction history, which makes them non-eligible for a local prison, so to speak, right? They have a prior history that gets them there. I think another interesting stat, though, is the overall probation supervision, those under supervision, has gone down since 2013. It was roughly about 400,000, just a little under that, and it's at 385,500 now. So the trends are going down in terms of the numbers under supervision in all categories, with the exception of those under what we call mandatory supervision, which is really more community-based supervision, which is a good thing, because when they're out there and if you're connecting them to services, that's how you're going to change behavior.
Was there any other questions from the audience? No? Well, I have one final question for you all. If you would take a moment to tell us something that surprised you, something that happened as a result of these historic reforms that you weren't expecting, or something you were expecting that didn't happen, just anything that has struck you about this incredible change.
I would say more than anything, that you see a hope amongst the MA population now that you maybe wouldn't have seen. I think the governor would tell you that in 1977, when he went from determinate to indeterminate sentencing and made that mistake, that he would not know that 40 years later we'd have 5,000 laws and 400 enhancements and inmates would be spending so much longer time in prison. And that as a result of the policy changes, the incentivizing of both those that have been done and those that might be done in the future, incentivizing inmates to participate in programming and address their criminal thinking, I think has created a hope amongst the inmate population that makes it much safer for our prison staff to work and better conditions. And very clearly, the less density of population makes it such a better opportunity in state prison for us to get to more programming for our inmates and hopefully at the end of the day deliver a better product out to probation and keep them out of my colleague, the sheriff's jails.
Ms. Still?
I think for me, especially not having been part of the county structure, just how stovepipe the communication or the lack thereof of systems. And I think an anticipated, but not to the level that it's grown, is the partnership not only with those criminal justice partners, but also your public health, your social service, your child support agencies, your local education, and the recognition that it's not just about the adults, right? It's about connecting the juvenile system and the work that's going on now on the front end regarding truancy and other alternatives. And I think that has been a very a wonderful aspect in terms of an additional outcome that wasn't necessarily anticipated with realignment, but because of realignment, those conversations and relationships have been created and strengthened.
Sure. I'm just encouraged by local law enforcement taking a less than myopic view of solving this problem, a more open look towards programming and different options as opposed to just hook them and book them, that there is There is some different direction that we have to take and we have to try.
Great. Thank you so much. Thanks to our panelists. And thanks to all of you for coming out. And to our report authors.